Previously on our last episode.
What were your expectations for this team, this group this year?
I didn't have any.
In football, basketball, you name it, doesn't matter what sport, Mount Pleasant and Midland, it's just disgusting.
Well, we wanted our revenge for losing to them. We didn't win a game against them last year, so we wanted that.
The team to beat if you want to be a district champ is Midland High.
Now it's Drew Barbie out in the open. Euro step around Davenport.
They're telling me to cut my hair, shave my mustache, stuff like that. So I got a little bit hot and started chirping back.
Inbound pass from Gulliver. And Drew Pareda points to the Midland student section. Mount Pleasant gets some sweet, sweet revenge against the guys that denied them a district title a season ago. They take it 62-53. Competing against formidable foes in the Saginaw Valley League, the basketball court at Mount Pleasant High School is truly where boys become men. During the 2021-22 hoop season, the Oilers traveled on a roller coaster of highs and lows. A team of individuals banded together to become stronger as a unit. A fierce rivalry with a familiar foe grew to a series of entertaining games. And a coach who embodied the very essence of Oiler pride wrote another chapter in his storybook career. This is their story.
What's the move? Can I tell the truth? If I was doing this for you, then I have nothing left to prove. Nah, this for me though. I'm just trying to stay alive and take care of my people. And they don't have no award for that. Trophies. Trophies.
A win over a big rival was a great way to start off the season, but the Oilers still had a lot of basketball ahead of them. In order to have success, Mount Pleasant needed to learn how to manage the ball in pivotal situations near the end of games. It's a lesson they would have to learn the hard way. Next, the Oilers made the hour-long trek to Grand Ledge, just a stone's throw away from Lansing, Michigan's capital. Buckle up, it's knocked forward by the Comets, and knocked over is Corey Davis, right off the start. He's feeling the hardwood. Gets it back here from Gottlieber. Drew Pareda had 12 points in his last game. Chest pass to Gottlieber. Penetrating. Kicking out for Drew Pareda. Oh, he got his mic going right off the hop. Elijah Hendricks pushing it up the court. Isaiah Bailey. Nice move. Couldn't find the finish. Ellis turning, fading away. Opens up his account on the night. Grand Ledge presented a bit of a size mismatch. 6'6 big man Nick Ellis towered over Mount Pleasant's smaller starting front court.
It was pretty tough. I got in foul trouble early, kind of just a couple dumb things. So we were kind of rotating guys in and out, and they had a big long kid that could shoot it, and you know, it's tough to guard when they can do that.
Bounce pass, intercepted by Watuzik. Looking across, finds Baroda Chuck, count the bucket and one.
Come up in the spot looking extra fly.
It's Bailey.
The Oilers exploded ahead as Pareda stayed hot, burying three more shots from behind the arc to take the team into the locker room, up 29-18.
Lays out for it. Williams can't find it. Pareda, look what I found!
The Comets came out of the locker room on a mission in the third quarter. Slowly but surely, they forged their way back into the game.
See if he can generate anything off the bench. Elijah to Steven from way out, 25-footer. Screen executed to perfection to Williams.
look now. Comets were down double digits going into the second half, and now it's just a four-point game with a lot of time left to be played here. Oilers cannot buy a bucket at the moment. Up 35-31, just a second. Comets will have to hurry. Isaiah Bailey from way past half court. No way! A miracle shot from Bailey. Just 1 point is all that separates these two teams. Could this be a miraculous comeback for the Grand Ledge Comets? 8 minutes still left. Although the camera didn't show it, Isaiah Bailey's miracle lob had gone in. The home crowd was raucous, and the Oilers looked stunned. Despite leading by double digits at the half, their advantage had been cut to a single point. And Nick Ellis will get an opportunity at the free throw line with his team trailing by one. Nick Ellis makes both free throws from the line, and just like that, the Comets have their first lead of the basketball game. Oilers are in trouble here in the fourth. One right now, they blew their lead, down three, just 2 minutes to go. Barbie heaves one, Gallagher, he got it! Bailey going to work, comes in, and Corey Davis takes the charge. Costly offensive foul committed by Bailey, possession to Mount Pleasant. Just when the Oilers thought they had sealed the victory, disaster struck. Full court press in effect for the Comets. Davis having trouble finding a good look for Pareda. Davis up the near side, stumbles, tries to call timeout. The play's still live. Elijah Hendricks picks it up, gets the layup. I don't believe what I'm seeing. Tie
game. I felt like it was kind of following me a little bit, but I mean, I didn't really, I guess, got to see that. But yeah, I was trying to call it. I thought about it. I said I maybe could call a timeout, but I guess I didn't have control of the ball.
Tie game, 18 seconds left. Wachusett back for Davis again. Gets by Hendricks this time. Coming up, oh, a poor turnover, another mistake by Davis. Hendricks will come up, misses that time. A foul, 5 seconds left. Comets go to the free throw line. A chance to win it right here. Disastrous turn of events for Corey Davis and Mount Pleasant.
I was trying to just go get a quick bucket, and then I just got picked from behind as well, which is really unfortunate.
The stress on Elijah Hendricks' shoulders was tangible as he nervously approached the foul line. He knew that he held the game in his hands. Colossal collapse for Mount Pleasant. Barring another bizarre occurrence to close this one out, as it's Hendricks. Shoots two. What'll likely be the last play of this game. Off the front iron. We stay tied at 44. Freddie Williams coming up to give him some positive encouragement. And oh, Williams just came in from outside the three-point arc. What will that mean? Officials conversing. That will void the second free throw attempt. With the game on the line, Freddie Williams made a costly mental error. The center had forgotten to line up for the foul shot. At the exact moment the referee bounced the ball to Hendricks for the free throw, Williams realized his mistake and ran to the key from outside the arc. It was a lane violation, denying the Comets of their second free throw attempt. Possession back to Mount Pleasant with 3 seconds remaining. Davis gets up for Barbie. He'll have to put up a prayer of his own. It wasn't far away, but this one will require overtime. With Logan Borodichuk fouled out, Drew Barbie will be forced to participate in this tip and somehow won it, albeit right into the hands of Hendricks, who makes one right off the bat. Comets start OT off with a bang. Hendricks on the ISO, sailing in. Oh, what an assist there by Williams. Pareda crosses over the timeline. Gottlieber in the corner, can't leave him open there. 1 point ball game in extra time. Comets trail by one. Hendricks gallivanting in, resilient bucket for number four. Flexes on him and a turnover. Bailey back in, won't go. Rebound Barbie, crisis averted for Mount Pleasant. hardly had a chance to catch our breath here in this OT period as Gottlieber tries again. Two in a row, Ryan Gottlieber. The few students that did make the hour-long trip from Mount Pleasant are jumping up and down. Gottlieber gets them up out of their seat. The first OT period was played at a frenetic pace, but neither team could find an edge. Double OT would be required to find a winner. Isaiah Bailey trying to generate something. It's a poor turnover, and Pareda trying to unleash some speed up and under. That's his trademark. And that will get the double OT period started. 2-point advantage, Oilers. Pareda, 2:30 to go in double OT. Still tied here. Gottlieber, wide open path. He's been clutch all night. Gets another big field goal for his team. 4 seconds is all that remains for Grand Ledge. Have to get it up the floor. Have to make a 3-point shot. Steven Hendricks for Freddie Williams from half court off the side of the backboard. And the Mount Pleasant Oilers stay undefeated. They're 2-0, hand Grand Ledge their first loss of the year and squeak out the win. It wasn't pretty, but they got it done. 59-56, the final, and a cardiac affair here in Grand Ledge.
I hit a big three in the fourth quarter that Drew Barbie passed me. And I hit some big threes in overtime.
We just made big plays. We had Ryan Gottlieber dropped like 9 in the overtime. That was crazy.
I had a couple shots to win the game. I missed them, but we still won at the end. So it was pretty good.
And, you know, we just got it done. You know, it was a great team win. You know, we had a lot of mess ups that game. And, you know, we just kept picking each other up and kept fighting.
I think that showed the fortitude and the toughness that this group had. Yeah, it also showed the lack of IQ at a time, like kind of loose with the ball, kind of their personality. It's kind of the minds of those kids. They didn't quit. They just kind of were tough-minded kids that, no, we're just going to keep competing. And that kind of showed me that in the Grand Ledge game.
If there's anything I would remember from that game, it's the atmosphere, and it was a fun place to play. Double overtime game, and we pulled it out, and that was a big win to go, I think, 2-3-0 into winter break. So it was really important.
After coming away with wins in consecutive road games, it was time for the Oilers' home opener. Mount Pleasant's first home game was much anticipated, and there was no shortage of fans.
We got a good team, we win some games, and we have some fun, we get loud. We help the team win the game.
And do you think, are your Oilers going all the way this year?
Oh, I think so. We have a good team, we can really shoot, we got some scorers, good defense, we got it all.
I'm Kyle Saitama, and I'm a senior at Mount Pleasant High School. Sadly, I had to miss a couple, but every single game I was able to make, we won. There's always, like, chance. You definitely get into it with the other student section, whether it's chirps or just getting louder, just having more energy. I've watched myself for a little bit, and, like, I definitely know that if I was in the other student section, I'd be, like, getting annoyed at me. So I guess, I don't know. It's kind of funny. It's definitely a fun thing.
Great student section. You look at those, that core group of kids, you know, 6, 7, 8 of them that went to every game. We had them traveling to friggin' Grand Ledge and had them traveling all over the place, and they had their hard hats on and they had whatever they had. And we had really, really, really good support. And I know not just myself, but the kids appreciated it. And that's stuff those kids will remember. Those players will remember those kids being goofy and acting like clowns on the sideline and cheering them on and giving them energy. They'll remember that for as long as they live, so.
The Oilers were feeling the love. Their game against Bay City Central was over before it began, with Mount Pleasant mopping the floor with the Wolves 91-52, despite rotating their entire bench constantly. Although the game was a bit of a snooze fest, it did provide a chance for Mount Pleasant's young stars to shine bright.
Can you just introduce yourself?
I'm Drew Barbie, part of the basketball team, golf team. Moved to Mount Pleasant this year. It's been fun. I've been playing on a little tyke hoop since probably like 3. I came off the bench, which I didn't bother me at all. But I came in, kept us going, feed everybody, just get buckets, I guess. I like being on the wing and then going from the wing to get to my spot wherever I want to score, but I can do everything.
Really good, high IQ kid, does a lot of things right. Handles it well, passes it well, shoots it well, rebounds it well. Huge addition for us. His role got bigger as the year went on. I think he became more comfortable with the team. I became more comfortable with him as far as what he could and couldn't do, and became more aware of what his abilities were. Yeah, very pleased. And we were very, very fortunate for him to come in for sure. He was a great spark for us. It fit a role for him. He could come in and give us instant offense, right? He could come in and give us that spark to kind of get us going, or to if we were going, to kind of give us that extra push to keep us going.
Drew Barbie is shy, but don't let that fool you. He's got serious game. That's in large part because of his father, Central Michigan basketball coach Tony Barbie.
My dad, he's helped a lot. He's gave me like a lot of opportunities to work out. Taught me how to shoot, how to dribble, do everything. Yeah, that's a big part of our life, I guess. Talk about basketball, watch basketball, just teaches me it.
On April 23rd of 2021, Central Michigan announced the hiring of former Kentucky assistant basketball coach Tony Barbie. For CMU fans, it meant the start of a new era of Chippewa basketball. But for Coach Barbie's son, Drew, it meant leaving all his friends and teammates behind and moving 500 miles north to a new state, a new school, and a new basketball team.
I thought it was gonna be tough, but I like fit right in up here. The city, I did not like it at all, but I kind of got used to it. A lot less people, a lot less things to do, but it's been fun hanging out with everybody. Coming to the school was fun, all the people joking around, having fun. It's kind of similar to Kentucky. It's just it's colder a lot longer here. It's freezing. I don't like the snow. I wish it was summer all the time.
With his trademark red locks bobbing up and down the court, Drew Barbie is always hard to miss. He stood out even more than usual against Central, putting up his first double-digit performance as an Oiler with 13 points. Although the Oilers were only 3 games into the season, they would enter a lengthy 3-week pause for Christmas break after their meeting with Bay City Central. In their first game back from the pause, Mount Pleasant visited the Lapeer Lightning.
The first game back from break, the whole team was rusty. We just weren't really playing like a team.
The Oilers' sloppy play continues as Pareda hurls that one into the Lapeer bench. Gottlieber, his intended target.
Just had a stagnant offensive game, and it was our first game back from winter break, so I think that had a little bit to do with it, not to make excuses.
Brodichuk, the corner three, came up with air, and he'll be serenaded by the home student section of Lapeer. Poor shot by Brodichuk.
I just remember, kind of being annoyed. We couldn't get anything going, and kind of was like blah game, and a couple of us were sick, and I was a little dead, and we hadn't played in a little while, so I was like, it was just annoying for me. It was bad. I think a little bit of it was lack of focus, a little bit of less time in the basketball court, and then coming right back to a game, and it is what it is.
Davis, penetrating, gets blocked, falls to Nahr. Pareda dishes to Gottlieber, 3, count it! Bennett, guarded by Brodichuk, gives to Owen Boyle, 3-pointer from the wing, go! The two opponents traded punches until late in the fourth quarter. Lead by 2, and the press is on here late in the game. Turned over to Barbie. Can the Oilers generate some offense? To the corner from Gottlieber. Doesn't like the look, finds Watuzik. Now Pareda, huge 3-pointer. Oilers take the lead, 56-55. They're on top. Lightning, down 1. In the hands of Cole Bennett. Gives to Johnson. Bennett, trapped on the side. Nowhere to go. He's going to heave it across. That's out of the reach of Owen Boyle and out of bounds. What should be the dagger for the Lapeer Lightning as they turn it over. Just like against Grand Ledge, the game's outcome would be decided
by the Oilers' ability to manage the ball in crunch time. With less than 10 seconds remaining, all they had to do was cleanly inbound and dribble out the clock to seal the W. Tough place to put it in the corner has Pareda. Bounces it down. Oh, he turned it over. It's Jesse Johnston. The layup with no time on the clock. Pareda will have to heave one. The Peter Lightning steal the game here on home court. Heroics from Jesse Johnston off a poor turnover from Barbie. Again, the Oilers had failed to manage the ball when it mattered most. This time, it had cost them dearly. Jesse Johnston and the Lapeer Lightning had shocked the Mount Pleasant Oilers.
Can you walk through that a little bit? Like, what was going through your head on that play at the end?
Well, I think we had a little miscommunication. Like, I was putting my hand up. I think Drew wanted me to throw it over his head, like, back towards the basket. But he said I was under the basket, so he didn't want to throw it. But I saw him, like this at first. And I thought I could get it around the guy. So he just tried to force it in there, and that didn't work out, clearly. He got over and took it, and I was like, oh, my God.
I mean, we were just sad. We expected to, you know, not lose for at least until, like, Glenn Blake maybe. But it was just unlucky. Kill him out of bed ending pass, and there's nothing you can do about it.
My teammates say I would laugh it off, but I was kind of mad. But then we started winning. The mood was bad the next day at practice and stuff like that, but we got off to a pretty hot start again after that, so.
The beauty of high school basketball is that you don't have much time to stew over losses. 3 days later, the Oilers were back on their home court, hosting the Cadillac Vikings. The Vikings were a perennial contender in the defensive-minded Big North Conference. Their main man, Cole Genema. The Oilers would have to keep an eye on the Vikings' senior unicorn. There was also another hurdle the Oilers would have to surmount that evening.
Hello everyone and welcome to the Hardwood. Calvin Keyes here, accompanied by former middle school basketball sensation Jack Urban.
Calvin, I'm really excited to see this game. You know, this is a big test for Mount Pleasant. They've lost four key players, you know, due to some injuries. Deontay Browns has been out with a finger injury, and Wyatt Urban has been out with a quad injury. And Omar Tutin and Drew Barbie are out for an unconfirmed illness. So, really, it's next man up mentality for these Oilers.
It's just as important for the guys who are maybe not getting the minutes for majority of the games to get those reps in practice, because it's always a next man up mentality. You have to have that, right? All of a sudden, because one guy goes down, you don't just stop. You don't say, okay, well, we're going to forfeit our games. No, you got to get out and you got to compete. And if the expectation is that when you're on this team, you compete and you do what you can, well, that's where the practice time comes in and getting those reps in practice so that you are prepared. So when your opportunity is there, you step up and pick up your team when they need you.
Tipping this one back on the bigger. Cadillac will start things off tonight. Hands off for Genema. Don't be deceived. The big guy has quite a shot, and he shows that right there to get us started. First basket of the night goes to the Vikings. Fast break the other way. Fed down low. Huge block by Davis. Take it on the fast break as Pareda takes it on the fast break here. Spinning that one in. Bringing along. Cutting up the middle. Kicks out for Gottlieber. Corner three. Gottlieber gets it to go. Down for Genema. Spinning off Davis. Knocks him over. No call. And sinks the 15-footer. 6-3 junior. Find Genema from deep. Pareda taking it in. Oh, what a move.
A little up and under.
Moves quickly to Pareda. Now he'll fire. Falling down. Knocking it down. Drew Pareda. Tried to hand off for Davis as Borodichuk sailed one. Probably wouldn't have counted anyways. But as things are going to stand at the half, Cadillac Vikings leading over the Mount Pleasant Oilers by a point, 27-26. It's been a good one, and I hope you'll stick around for the second half of action as this one continues after the break.
At halftime, it was clear the Oilers had another barn burner on their hands. So far, both teams had rode on the backs of their thoroughbreds. Cole Genema had put his team on his back with 15 of the Vikings' 27 first half points. Mount Pleasant's dynamic guards Drew Pareda and Ryan Gottlieber were having another routine day at the office, booking 9 first half points apiece.
Klein waiting to check into the game. Polk will join him. Davis up the left side, slashing to the rim. Doesn't seem to get any bounces to go his way right now as Jaden Montag. Davis, wide open path to the hoop. Inbound of a rota truck. Turning. Still got it through. But still putting on a good performance. Their horses, Gottlieber, especially Ryan Gottlieber today, are coming through. He came through again. Came through the paint that time. Found an opening. Brown. Howell fires. Yes.
The SWAT team was deployed in the fourth quarter as Barodachuk and Genema served up some leftover stuffing from Thanksgiving.
Genema, double trapped, has to unload. Great feed there by Howell.
Great block by Loden Barodachuk.
Up by 3. Davis, looking to add to the lead. A little bit of stuffing there from Genema. Coach Benzenberg's mind to make.
The second half was a low-scoring game of cat and mouse, yet the Oilers led 53-51 heading into the final minute.
Trying to shake around Brown. Brown will reach in to stop the clock.
Normally, the Vikings would be smart to foul Davis, who sported the worst free throw percentage out of the Oilers on the floor. But that night, he had shot 50% from the field and 100% from the stripe. Davis was dialed in.
Makes it. He'll get another one. 3-point game. This could ice it. Does Davis have the mental fortitude to make this shot? And he does. Timeout called. Wow. Corey Davis, ice in his veins. Have to put up a shot here quickly. You knew they were going to try to get it to Genema. Didn't like his shot. Howell. Yes. Huge make with 11 to go.
Cadillac hurried up the hardwood and earned 3 points courtesy of an unlikely hero. Sophomore forward, Charlie Howell. It was only his second bucket, but it couldn't have come at a better time for the Vikings. 12 ticks remained. Just like in their previous game against Lapeer, a successful inbound pass was the only thing the Oilers needed to do to chalk up a win.
Have to get it in here. Brodachuk, see if he can heave it in. Didn't like the look to Gottlieber, short. Heaves one up, batted away. A chance, 10 to shoot. David Brown,
down the corner.
Out for Montag. Howell, looking to move over. Takes the shot, he missed it.
Lucky for Cadillac, their coach Ryan Benzenberg had called timeout before the ball left Howell's hands. The Vikings, down by a single point, would get a chance to scheme up the perfect play. They had 4 seconds to find a field goal.
Gottlieber, Davis, trying to stay tight on Genema. Baker, trying to throw it in. Out of bounds. Mount Pleasant's going to get it with 3 seconds left.
Mount Pleasant had dodged a bullet, and they would get a second chance to put the ball in play cleanly.
Rodachuk, he'll have the task of heaving this ball in again. Has Davis open on the far
side. No.
But it got tipped. Turned over. Basket falls, but it's not.
Shot. On the floor.
It's not going to count.
Oh, my goodness.
Given a chance at redemption, Mount Pleasant's second inbound play had been executed even more poorly than the first. When the dust settled, the call emerged. Corey Davis had committed a foul on the floor on Cadillac's Aiden Gurdon, but the Vikings were in the double bonus, so even though Gurdon's lucky lob wouldn't count, he would shoot 2 free throws. With 0.2 seconds left, his foul shots would decide the game.
Aiden Gurdon, the senior.
This is the end of the game right here.
His coach told him he wasn't going to be given a starting job going into this season, but he embraced it and has brought a lot of heart to this team. Can he be the difference here tonight? Down a point. Needs one to tie it. Rattles out.
Gurdon had one more try at tying the game and forcing overtime. No matter which team they were cheering for, every fan was on the edge of their seat. Some couldn't bear to watch, some had fingers crossed. The rubber sphere was dribbled, then lifted into shooting form, then released by Gurdon. Silence enveloped the gym as the ball traveled on a high arc towards the hole.
A chance for Gurdon to tie this one up and send it to OT. Can he do it? Free throw up.